can easily understand.
Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth?
What? Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you.
What we got here is a failure to communicate.
Welcome to the Uncommon Communicator Podcast. Your hosts, James Gamble and Brandon Thompson, are here to bring you enlightenment to the topic of communication.
Morning, Brandon.
Good morning, James. How are we doing?
Good. You nailed that, man.
Yeah.
I assumed you would.
There was no point in this time.
No. I didn't even think about it.
As he points in my general direction. What are we here to talk about this week, James?
So today, this week, we're going to talk about inferences versus assumptions.
Oh. My goodness. Assumptions is almost like a naughty word.
It is taken with a bad connotation, right? Like, yeah. The whole thing going back to what does assume spell out, right?
And yeah. I was like, I've always heard it as what does assumption stand for?
Yeah.
And then there's the, it's a donkey, you, me, and that's about it, right?
Yeah. I like it. It doesn't hit as hard when we clean it up in the G.
Yeah, I mean, because the spelling doesn't quite work out, but you know, what are you going
to
do?
But there is a bad connotation to assumptions, but I think we're going to determine that there is a place for it. But mm-hmm. It's important to talk about assumptions and inferences being kind of a little bit different, but they're very distinct differences, but they have a tie together that one leads to the other. So we're going to start with talking about assumptions, and we're going to talk about inferences, mm-hmm. because inference is also a key component or a key skill in critical thinking.
It is
as well.
And we did just talk about critical thinking last week as well. So, you know, we like to try and build on these podcasts, right? We're building these skills. So this is us building our critical thinking skills with inferences and assumptions. I will say that assumptions can also be a bit of a, so it's not necessarily like a skill, but it can almost be a skill that you can use.
Well, I can't wait to hear your take on it, because you believe that assumptions can be used for good, whereas they have that negative connotation. Let's jump into that first. We're going to talk about assumptions. Now, assumptions are beliefs or statements that are taken for granted. Mm-hmm. They're just accepted to be true, even though you don't have any kind of concrete evidence or any kind of proof.
Mm-hmm. You're jumping into conclusions. It is very much like what an assumption is, right? When you get cut off in traffic, you just assume that guy's a jerk, right? And who knows, man, maybe the Pope cut you off. Is the Pope a jerk?
I don't think. Did you know the president is no longer allowed to drive a vehicle?
I mean, that's probably like a good decision.
At least for the current president, he might, you know, won't even be able to drive his own wheelchair the way he's going now. But I don't think the Pope drives either. But you're right. What if the Pope cuts you off? Do you think he's the Dalai Lama? What if he's in town visiting and he cuts you off? Did he have ill intent? Or did he have to hurry up and get somewhere to bring enlightenment to somebody?
Is that right? So you know, you can make assumptions like that. And you can make assumptions that the driver that cut you off is a jerk, and you can very much be wrong because you are just jumping to conclusions without any facts. That is what assumptions are in a nutshell.
And the basis of an assumption is it's based on personal beliefs, right? Mm-hmm. You're going to have a bias in there.
Because anybody that's going to cut me off is a turd blossom.
Yes.
Right?
That hashtag turd blossom. Prior experiences, because you've seen that car before,
because
right?
Because when I get cut off and I have to slam on my brakes and jolt everybody forward, that the person that caused that is a
turd blossom.
Nailed
I was going to say wagon, but the idea blossom. That you have prior experiences, and that person's probably going to be, it used to be the BMW, and then now moving to Colorado, it's the Subaru drivers
baby.
But you know what I've seen lately have been the Infiniti drivers.
Oh.
I don't know what it is with those guys. They pay way more money for their cars. I get cut off a lot for
and
those.
And they're infinitely more of jerks when they cut you off.
Maybe that's part of it. It's like, you got to sign up. Like, you're going to be, you know, hold up to our norm here.
We have a standard of jerkness that you need to uphold when driving.
There are like cultural norms, generalizations. Those are all kind of the basis of assumptions.
Yes, they are.
Now, the issue with an assumption is typically there's a lack of evidence.
That's very much what it is, right? Like, we have evidence that they cut me off, and that's a jerk thing to do, but that does not entirely make them a jerk, right? Kind of like how when you run into – you know, they tell you, like, you know, don't meet your heroes or don't run into celebrities, right? It's because they can't be awesome all the time. So every now and then you're gonna get a bad interaction with a celebrity every now and then. And it's not because they're a bad human being, but just it's hard, man. But when you get that evidence that, oh, yeah, they're a jerk. Oh, well, now they're just a jerk for every other interaction ever.
They do. They especially at that level, right? They get that reputation for being that jerk because we expect. expect that Robert Downey Jr. is Iron Man all the time.
All the time. And ain't nobody Iron Man all the time.
Well, he might be, right, actually, in his mind, right?
I mean, you know, when you got the suit and you've done 8 movies.
So that lack of evidence is really, that's really kind of, I think, the key component to
that. That is the core. There's right? not a lot of thinking going on with assumptions, right? You are jumping to conclusions. You are not critically thinking. You are not analyzing, right? You're not interpreting. You're not analyzing. You're not communicating. That's what assumptions is, right? Assumptions is you are accepting something and then going forward, right? Like you're jumping to conclusions. This is how it is. And then we're going to go for it.
But how could you use assumptions for good?
It's very much an action taking thing, right? So we've used the example of being cut off. And that's, you know, not exactly one, or and then that leads to probably bad things because the Pope cuts you off and you call the Pope a jerk. You're probably going to hell. I don't think you get to call the Pope a jerk and, you know, live.
You can't even think it. Right? They're going to know.
Jesus knows, God. But it also helps in decision making, kind of in general, and in action taking. Assumptions are fast. Right. Critical thinking takes time. Critical thinking and inferences. Let me just stick with critical thinking because we're going to get to inferences here in a minute. Right. It takes time to analyze the data. It takes time to come up with your own perspective. And then it's going to take time to communicate this and kind of like, you know, talk about this in a forum where an assumption might be wrong or right. Okay. An assumption might be wrong or right.
You have at least a 50% chance you're going to be right or wrong with an assumption to some degree at the minimum, right?
Yeah, right. Like, and because a lot of assumptions are based off of, right? It even says, we even went in here, right? Based on personal beliefs or prior experiences, okay? Yeah. So there is a history with the thought process that you have. So let's just say 50% just because we'll blame this as 2 outcomes, that your assumption is right or your assumption is wrong. And then it causes you to jump to action quickly. Is what an assumption does, right? An assumption is fast. And there are times, so for instance, at Starbucks, right? Someone might walk in, they're looking for their mobile order, and we can't find it first off, right? We can't find it right away. And then natural thing that happens. Now, what we will do behind the counter, because this happens all the time, there's a store at 58th and Kipling, there's a store at 50th and Kipling, and then there's us at 55th. So there's a 58, a 50, and a 55. That's a lot of
50s.
Right? It is perfectly normal for somebody to accidentally click 58 instead of 55 or 50 instead of 55. So they come in here and they're looking for their order. And, you know, their first assumption is like, yo, man, you guys going to make my drink or not? And yes, we are. But the other assumption that we have of them sometimes is, hey, did you send your drink to the right order? Did you actually send it through? Right? We're assuming that the customer did not uphold their end of the bargain. Right. And look, I think probably 7 or 8 times out of 10, that's what ends up happening. That, right?
Well,
yeah. Well, I mean, look, the system's pretty darn good, man. You put in the order, the ticket prints off, and you're good to go, right? So when we can't find someone's order, our first assumption is like, hey, look, did you go through this, right? Like that. In asking that question, we are assuming that they are in the wrong, right? Most of the time, we are correct. That speeds things along.
And that's okay? A high percentage.
Yeah,
sure.
It is a high percentage.
That basically you're saying that's very subjective.
It is, right? Based off of our prior experiences and our personal beliefs that we're good at our jobs and that we don't mess things up like that, we are assuming that it's on you and that you just need to, you know, you send it to the wrong store, you need to send it all the way through, something along those lines.
Yeah.
Right? That's what we are assuming when we have this. And in doing so, it either causes them to go out and grab their phone real quick, then they can come in, show us receipts, say, yep, this is what happened, this is what happened, right? As opposed to be like, well, hold on real quick. Can you walk me through what happened? Tell me your experiences. Like, what was your critical thinking, right? And is it a way to go about that? Yeah. Is it probably like a politer way to go about them instead of kind of accusing them of, you know, being stupid and ordering to the wrong store?
Well, using those words, maybe. But I think I love your approach of that being like a quicker decision, because you wouldn't take the time to logically help them think through every single time, because you're basing it on some preconceived notions, experience, mm-hmm. right? All of those things, biases, individual perspectives tie into that idea of it being subjective, but it is a quicker way to action without going through that whole process, because you are almost leading into, and this is why we're comparing the inference to assumption, is there is a little bit of basis of knowledge mm-hmm. that you start with to get to that assumption. But in looking at a role, the role of an assumption, it does help build to your area of inference.
Yeah, right. So like it's if an inference is having like the entire foundation of a house or a building, an assumption is kind of like walking on the high stick. What are those called? When you walk on the sticks, the stilt man, right? Like, are there people that can walk on stilts and get away with it all the time? Yeah, you can make all those assumptions. But every now and then, you're probably going to, the stick's going to crack and you're going to fall flat on your face when you assume something. That's fine. The foundation to the house is going to be a lot stronger.
If the foundation is tying it back to the idea of is on the inference. So kind of wrapping up the assumptions, though, it's not bad if you understand where it's coming from and you understand that your biases are in there. It's a good way to get to a kind of a quick decision sometimes where it's 50-50. You don't have to take the time to get there. But I think it's kind of that it falls into that rule of thumb. Do you think the assumptions fall into the rule of thumb
idea? I would say so, right? Because you can't. In a rule of thumb, you tend to kind of jump to the conclusions that your heuristics have told you to. And that's what I would say. So an assumption is for use assumptions when you need to take action quickly. Assuming is timely. It's a time saver. But as we've established before in communication and or just working with other people, you can't always, you got to slow down, right? We've talked several times. You got to take a step back. You got to talk things through. You got to do that. That's not what assuming is. So assuming can lead to problems, right? When you need to be sitting down and talking about these things, assuming turns you into a donkey, right? But if you don't have time to sit down and talk about it, assuming can be a great tool to kind of just get you done.
I think where assumptions get its bad rap isn't necessarily in making those kind of decisions, because you do make some assumptions, you jump to conclusions, stuff like that. Where assumptions get the bad rap is, and this is probably the worst one in regards to communication, is I assumed you were going to write that email.
I thought you were going to do something that you weren't, that was never communicated. The lack of communication in assumptions is the problem with communication.
That's the biggest hiccup.
The devil. Yeah, that is the devil side of assumptions, is that you can't assume someone is going to actually do something.
When it was as easy as making a quick text, a phone call, or some kind of communication to confirm it, mm-hmm. you make that assumption that that's going to happen. And then you even throw in there, like, what if that guy's so busy, they forget, nonetheless, that they were mm-hmm. never going to do it, which is the worst assumption as well, too. So that's, I think, on the communication side where assumptions become
problematic.
Evil. Yeah, it's very much a problem.
But sometimes in decision-making, assumptions are just fast and they're beneficial.
Exactly. So turning it towards inferences, as we had stated before, it's really kind of the assumption can be the basis of you building on your inference. Now, what is an inference? It's about drawing conclusions and making predictions based on the evidence that you have at hand. It brings you to making logical deductions. Mm-hmm.
Deductions, not decisions?
Deductions.
Okay. You sound like Spock over here. Should I throw up, live long and prosper?
Please do.
So inferences, live long and prosper?
Anytime you use the word logical, I think of Spock as well, too. Because they are very, but you talk about deductions. When I think of deductions or deduce, I think of like Sherlock. Yeah.
Okay,
because he's taking and making very much logical deductions, not decisions, just deducing from the information that he has to get to the result of where he's at.
That's what an inference is. Because of point A, we can direct to point B, which then will get us to point C, which arrives us at the conclusion of point D, which is also graphing, which is basically math too.
We're back to the math.
We are. I was like, dude, the math has trickled into this week apparently as well.
So the basis of it is you're looking at observable facts, whereas before, remember, you're going off of kind of those feelings.
Feelings and like instant kind of vibes. Yeah, yeah.
The data you're observing, you're taking information that is either directly or even indirectly part of it or provided in there, and then you're coming to that basis of understanding. Mm-hmm.
And then and having a basis of understanding is probably the biggest part of an inference, right? Like I said, I called it a foundation of a house, right? That is that understanding that you are gathering from an inference that you're not getting from an assumption.
And remember, going back to assumptions, there's a lack of evidence. You are just kind of moving from that. In this inference idea, it's evidence-based. Mm-hmm. You need some evidence to make good inferences.
Right, yes. And what's like the objective of an inference?
Well, I think the idea is that it is objective versus subjective. Okay. The assumption was subjective. The idea is it's objective because you are now involved in interpreting the evidence. Mm-hmm. So that makes an objective observation. And inferences strive to be objective and follow, again, back to that logical principle.
Yeah. The idea behind an inference is to take time, think about it, be smart, be logical, maybe, you know, talk to other people and gather information from that, which you're not going to probably do when somebody cuts you off in the middle of traffic.
You don't think you're going to go into an inference of logical deduction of why they did it?
Yeah, I'm not going to try to gather information and, you know, find out, you know, maybe the guy's like wife's in labor and he's just trying to get to the hospital real fast.
Well, and you're not going to gauge that information based on the fact that they were driving an Infiniti.
Yeah.
Knowing that he was just, there's just no way he's got the pregnant wife in the car. Mm-hmm. He's just that jerk.
He's just that jerk.
Right.
Because he signed
that assumption.
He signed that contract that we now know that all Infiniti drivers have to sign.
It has to be part of it.
Yeah.
But the whole idea is that the role of inferences is to go beyond the explicit information and to make really educated guesses.
Yeah. It's an educated guess, right? We don't exactly know what's going to happen. We don't know the full story. No one came in here and told us exactly what happened. No one told Sherlock Holmes, you know, that it was Colonel Mustard in the diner room with a lead pipe.
It's always Colonel Mustard.
Well, that's actually, so have you seen the second Charlie's Angels movie?
Mm-mm.
The one with Bernie Mac? Yeah, Bernie Mac's in it. The reason why Colonel Mustard in the dining room with a lead pipe comes up, there's a scene, so, you know, the Charlie's Angels are out doing Charlie's Angels things, and Shia LaBeouf is playing a game of Clue with Bernie Mac, because Bernie Mac's, like, the witness protection version, so Bernie uh-huh. Mac's protecting Shia LaBeouf, and they're playing, he invites him over to his mammy's house, and they're playing a game of Clue. And he bowled, like, and it cuts from, like, the inaction scene or whatever to Bernie Mac going, "I know who did it. I know. It was Colonel Mustard in the dining room with a lead pipe." And he just, like, throws the card down or whatever. And everybody's like, "How did you get anywhere near that answer?"
Because he made an inference.
Yes. Yeah, so right? The next time so now y'all know why it's Colonel Mustard in the dining room with a lead pipe instead of, I don't even know the other members of Clue.
I don't know. But it's important to point out, too.
It's also fun to say that Colonel Mustard gave him the mustard.
Gave him
the welcome idioms. To the bunny trail of the uncommon communicator, ladies and gentlemen. It's a good time. So we're hopping down it.
Assumptions are definitely, you know, at that low level decision making. Inferences still aren't the top of the logical food chain, but they are helping us get better there. It's bridging the gaps of knowledge. And it's helping you get there through some type of reasoning.
It's an appetizer.
But an inference still is not a complete evidence-based, right? You're still inferring. You're mm-hmm. still in there making some decisions based off of the evidence that you have, which I would think is a majority of the time that we're there. Never do we have all of the information. And this is like if you really study a lot of like interrogations mm-hmm. when they're interrogating people, they're having to take inferences from stuff. They're building some evidence based off of how it's said, you know, what is said, timing and all that. But they're still having to make some inferences to help them get to that next level. But it's never, nobody walks in there immediately and goes, "Yep, it was me." Right?
Unfortunately not.
So they have to infer that the evidence that they have in front of them. And that's where I think it's important to take it from assumption. You assume that they're the guilty one. And then you get to the idea of inference. Well, they were at the place with the lead pipe. They were in what room were they in?
Dining room.
The dining room. But you can kind of make some assumptions that you were there, but then you start inferring with the evidence that is pointing to that point. But inference is at least helping and is another key component to critical thinking, is getting from the assumption to the inference portion of your assessment.
Well, so you're a bit of a chef. Do you fancy yourself a bit of a chef? Because you do a good chunk of cooking.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So, like, if critical thinking is going to be the actual meal at the very end, right, with the mashed potatoes, the steak, the gravy, the, you know, asparagus or whatever side you want. I don't know. What side would you like?
Broccoli.
Actually, I had to eat broccoli this week,
too. That's good for you.
No, it's terrible. Going
all the big people in the shows where they lose weight start with the broccoli.
Well, that's because it's atrocious and they don't want to eat it, so they just don't eat anything instead they lose a bunch of weight.
It works.
Anyway, but so if you think of it, like, an assumption is almost just like putting the pan on the stove, right? Like, it's very much just like the first little bit. And then, but an inference is starting to, like, you know, season the meat, mash the potatoes. It's like, it's building towards this final meal that is going to be your critical thinking and your actual like plan of action.
Yeah. So I like it. It's ingredients.
Yeah. Ingredients.
Right.
Yeah.
So we're building the ingredients and the steps to get to the final critical thinking decision fact, and inference is a very important part of it mm-hmm. because that's where you're applying the logic to it.
Yeah. And an assumption is maybe when you season your meat without actually using specific measurements every time.
So assumptions are subjective beliefs or statements made without a whole lot of strong evidence. Inferences yeah. are logical conclusions drawn from the available evidence that we have.
Mm-hmm. And you're asking those smart questions, right? These are evidence-based opinions.
And assumptions influence the whole process of making inferences. You start with assumptions. It's part of that process, maybe the starting point, which really gets you to the underlying beliefs. But the whole idea that inferences, they're more evidence-based, they're objective, they rely on a logical reasoning, observable facts. All of those things have helped build us to a point where we're making better and more accurate decisions.
Should we just assume to make inferences all the time?
Yes. And I would add to that the idea is they are certainly, yeah, they're built, again, to a food connotation. You've got to add the right ingredients in there to get to where we were going. And I think for me, the UC moment of today is to practice inference, because it's going to give you more accurate interpretation of the facts. What's your UC? What do you gather for a UC moment for today?
Oh, I was just going to assume that you had this one in the bag.
Oh, there it is. I have it in the pot. Oh, so yeah. I've taken the ingredients, which is, okay, so there's our UC moment for today. Practice inference for more accurate interpretation of the facts.
Yeah, dude. We're going to make some fat people with all these meals.
Holy cow. It's just portion control.
Yeah, there you go. Portion control.
I don't think that's our UC moment, but that's all I got.
That's all I got.
See you. Bye.